It's morning somewhere, right? How'd you guys have did you have a good Thanksgiving? Yeah? Anybody want to say anything they're thankful for? No. All right, praise the Lord for your marriage. Brothers and sisters, very good. That's a good thing too. Anybody else? For God being in the midst of it all, praise the Lord. John, did you have something there?
Yeah, praise the Lord for good family Thanksgiving. My own family don't see it all.
Yeah, praise the Lord. And Cherry had a good Thanksgiving until she had to go into work and fight off everybody at Walmart, right? Anything else to thank the Lord? Anybody else want to thank the Lord for anything? God's grace and provision. Miss Barb? You made it. You made it. That's right. Well, it's because they wanted to see the Christmas lights. Anything else? Back there, I think I see one. No? What was that? Dads and moms. Thank the Lord for dads and moms. I thank the Lord for that too. Well, praise the Lord. And we did come through the Thanksgiving season. But you know what? That doesn't mean we stop giving thanks. That means that every day we continue thanking God more than once a day, right? Well, every second of the day we should be thanking God. And so we have a couple announcements as we get started here tonight. Of course, this Thursday is the Christmas parade. And some people have signed up to be helping out with that. We could use all the help we can get. Again, those who want to help get the float ready, be here at 10 o'clock Thursday morning to help get the float ready. And those who have the desire to walk and hand out tracts or pass out candy, as well as just possibly ride in the van, or even maybe be sitting on the float, be here at 4 o'clock. And we will have that ready for you. Please come out and help support not only the church, but the city of Altoona. And just think about many of the people in Altoona that have given us the freedom to be able to have parades, even a Christmas parade. As far as I'm concerned, I think that's what it's called, right? The Christmas parade. That hasn't changed yet. And let's just remember what Christmas is about, and thank God that we can have the Christmas parade and the church can be represented. Also, tonight is the last opportunity you have to sign up and pay for the Omega Christmas dinner. $12, right? And I was reading the screen this morning, and it looks like a pretty good dinner.
Good dinner.
And so you want to be here for it. And if I got it correct, am I allowed to say what I think is in being involved in this in the service? Let me see. It's not up there. Okay. I think the carillons are going to carillon, right? They're going to ring their bells. Is that? Am I right? No. Okay. I thought I saw somewhere that they were ringing the bells. Oh, the ladies' tea. That's where it was. Okay. So they're not going to ring their bells. But that's all right. Micah, is Micah here? No? Micah Klaus is speaking. Am I correct on that? That's not at the ladies' tea? Just making sure. He can speak at the ladies' tea too, but...
He's going to speak on Merry Christmas.
He's going to speak on what?
His initial is
MC. So Micah Klaus on Merry Christmas. Is that true? Okay, because I just joked with him this morning about that, and I didn't know I did. It was true then. Okay, got it. Anyway, you want to come out for that $12. You can sign up out in the sheet in the hallway, but you also need to pay tonight, and I think you pay. They all pay you, right, Gramps? He'll take all the money you can give him. So that is for this Saturday at 5 o'clock. So you want to make sure you be there for that, as it is a special event. We're going to go ahead and have our scripture reading right now, and I ask you all to stand out of respect of the reading of God's Word. As we read Revelation chapter 12, we're not going to read the whole chapter. We're not going to read verses 1 through 17. We're going to read the first 9 verses of Revelation chapter 12. And we will be reading this responsively. Revelation chapter 12. And the word of the Lord said, "And there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And there appeared another wonder in heaven. And behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads. And she brought forth a man-child, who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And her child was caught up unto God, into his throne.
And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she had a place
prepared of God, for they should be there 1,200 and 3 score days. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil, and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him." Thank you very much for the reading of God's word. And we're going to go ahead and sing some songs now. I guess this first one is pretty good to go along with what's happening tomorrow. So we'll go ahead and sing about the deer tomorrow today, and do the other stuff tomorrow.
All right, but tomorrow is deer season. The best part about deer season that I hunted for many, many years was lunch. I always enjoyed lunch. All right, all that good stuff. All right, 205 in your hymn book, "As the deer for the water, so my soul longeth after you." Just to be with the Lord and to draw upon his strength that he gives us day by day. The Lord is our only strength. I mean, we can't rely on the things of this world, the people of this world, but the Lord, as a deer panteth for that water, so our heart should pant for the strength of the Lord. Exactly. Closer, just a closer walk with thee. Exactly. Let's sing that one more time, okay? As the deer. Worshiping the Lord every minute of our day, of our lives. Well, you know, the church looks beautiful, doesn't it, with all the decorations? And I'm going to do something. We're going to sort of jump in and sing a Christmas carol. Don't tell anybody, okay? Don't tell anybody. because it's not in the program, and we always like to stick with the program.
That's chess.
That's right, yeah. So turn your hymn books to number 105, and we'll throw a Christmas carol in there because next week we'll probably start singing them again. But how about this Christmas carol? Go tell it on the mountain. That's what Christmas is all about, telling about what the Lord Jesus Christ came into the world to do, to save us from our sin. Let's sing it out now. Go tell it on the mountain. All right, ready? To God be the glory. We can thank God for the Son Jesus Christ, who came into the world to take away our sins. To God be the glory. Great things He hath done. Let's sing it out now.
Atonement for sin, and oh,
seated.
Yes. As we have our offertory, let's remember the Dua family. And I know a lot of people, I don't know a lot of people, nobody said anything to me about it, but think about you guys if you were in that situation. Now, of course, it's $1,000 a month there in Ghana, but it's a lot more here. And just think about if you were in that situation where your child was in the hospital and was able to be released, but you didn't have the money to be able to go in and pay for him to be released. Not only that, you don't have that money. Every day he's there longer, it's more money. Think about that situation when we're praying here, and ask God if he would ask you to give to the Dua family. And, of course, it was mentioned this morning that there's a variety of ways you can do that. You can write out a check, I guess either to the church or Way of Truth, putting Desmond or Dua or Desmond Dua, I would think, on the memo line. Whether that's to Faith Baptist Church or Way of Truth Ministries. You could also grab one of the envelopes in the pews and put 50s, 100s, you know, whatever you want to put in there, as up to or down to pennies. And anything towards that, I'm sure, is a help. So pray and ask God what he would want you to do, because if you think about the situation they're in where they could have their son back at home, yet they can't, what would you do? And you would hope that people were praying and being willing to help you out as well, I'm sure. So I'm going to ask the men to come forward to take the offering this evening. And Cindy Smith is going to play the piano during the offertory. And if one of the keys gets stuck down, it's because her fingers weighted down a little bit more than the last time we saw her. So we want to congratulate. I forgot your first name again. Doug. Doug and Cindy. I guess it's not new to you guys, but it's new to us, right? It was in October 15th. Is that what you said, Cindy? And so maybe sometime here it won't be Cindy Smith. Just a thought, right? So let's go ahead and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this evening. Lord, we do pray for the Dua family. And Lord, I can't imagine what it would be like to have a son or even a daughter in the hospital. And Lord, just know that he could be home with us but not have the funds to be able to do it. Lord, we know that you can provide anything. Lord, I pray that you would speak to us here tonight. Lord, I pray that you would work through us, so that tomorrow Desmond could come home. Lord, I just pray that we could see your mighty power through that. Lord, I also pray that you would work through this church. Lord, help us to grow closer to you. And Lord, help us to understand that what we have and maybe are not wanting to give up, Lord, we got from you. And the best thing we can do is give that back to you as an example of what we saw this morning in the baby dedication. I think of Samuel and his mom, Anna, and them just her praying, not being able to have a child, and promising to give it back to you if she was to have a son. And following through with that promise and seeing the great man that Samuel became, Lord, we thank you for that. We pray that we will look at that as an example for us all, whether we're talking about kids or money or possessions. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you.
Well, good evening, and as we take some time to pray for our missionary on the field, who's today is Rob Shank, and his ministries with Faith in Action in Washington, D.C. You know, we've just come through a time of election where the people of the United States got to voice and elect who they would select as the representative of the President of the United States. Now, Rob Shank has a ministry to where he gets to rub shoulders with a lot of these men. He gets to meet with the Supreme Court. Maybe they're coming in January. We might get a report that there's more Bible studies, individual time studying God's Word will take place in the White House as never before. You know, and I believe that God would be very, very, very willing to bless our nation again. If, as his word says, if we would humble ourselves and pray, that means we have a part to do. We need to stand behind the Faith in Action. We need to stand behind Rob Shank, his minister teams that he has down there, that they could reach into the Supreme Court, to the White House, that we could be one nation again under God. You know, a nation who the Lord is our God. You know, and this is possible by seeking the Lord in prayer. And as Chaz has prayed for finances for the Kendu and Desmond, we'll take a moment to pray for Desmond. That he's not healed from his infirmities right now. But God could do that. And we need to ask. He's just be able to be released. And there'll be a medication, a cost that will be ongoing until God finishes work. So we will pray for the Dua family, for Ken, and for Desmond as we seek the Lord. So if you would bow your heads. And Father, as we come before you, and as we think of the ministry in Washington, D.C., with Rob Shank, with Faith in Action, Father, I thank you for seeing the people of this United States do their part and go out and vote. Father, as your word tells us that anybody is in authority that you have appointed to that position. So, Father, we thank you for this Donald Trump who will be taking the office of the President of the United States. And, Father, what all that entails that he would open up your word. Father, that he would use the wise counsel of those who are taught and instructed into your word. That we may be a nation whose government is decided by thus saith the Lord. Father, we call on you to open up doors of ministries in Washington. People could be reached with your word. Father, as we understand, first of all, to pray for kings and all those in authority. And Father, that includes from the presidents completely down the line to our local magistrates, that we could see a nation that feared you in a very reverent way. Father, we come before you on behalf of Ken Doa and the family, and Father, to hear the reports of Ken's, now how he sold out to you. How he sold out to getting your word throughout the country. Father, where there's seems like no obstacles that's ever too big in his way, that as he seeks you don't carry him and see him through it. Now, Father, we're informed, and you've already known the situation with Desmond. Father, let your people, you know, if we don't take care of our own household, we're worse than if. So, Father, whether it be a couple mites or a couple dollars or a couple $100, that your people would reach out and do all that they can. And, Father, I ask this not for Desmond, not even for Ken, but, Father, that you would be exalted of the great and mighty things that you've done, even through the people here in the United States, to an individual there in Africa. We'll be quiet. We'll be quick. And we'll want to exalt your name and give you all the praise through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
All right, thank you very much, Ron, for the prayer for Desmond, and for your always reminding us of our missionaries. We need to pray for them at all times. 204 is a song that we sing mostly at Thanksgiving time, but you know it's a song we could sing every time we're here. Come, you thankful people, come. And the Lord has really blessed us so greatly here in America. And let's stand and sing this song. It's a song of thanks and adoration. 204, be thankful unto him and bless his holy name.
Paul wrote to Timothy, I'm ready to be offered. The time of my departure now is at hand. I've fought a good fight, my course is now finished. A crown now is waiting when before God I stand. There is laid up before me a crown of bright glory. That is why I must run this race faithfully. There is reserved for me up in heaven a mansion. That is where I shall live eternally. Peter said, I've got an inheritance waiting. It's incorruptible and fades not away. I am kept by God's power through faith unto salvation. It now is awaiting to be revealed someday. There is laid up for me a crown of bright glory. That is why I must run this race faithfully. There is reserved for me up in heaven a mansion. That is where of bright glory. That is why I must run this race faithfully. There is reserved for me up in heaven a mansion. That is where I shall live eternally. There is laid up for me a crown of bright glory. That is why I must run this race faithfully. There is reserved for me up in heaven a mansion. That is where I shall live eternally.
Thank you, Phil. And it is true that we as Christians have something to look forward to, don't we? Up in heaven, when this world is over and we are with the Lord in heaven. We praise the Lord for that. And tonight, I could hear that you were singing that song. And every time I hear that song about As the Deer, I pray that it's our... We're singing it because we mean it. As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. Is that where we are as Christians? Is that our desire? You know, this evening I am going to be giving this message, preparing for Christmas biblically. But that particular song really expresses it. If we go into Christmas with this thought, this song on our hearts, then Christmas will have a greater meaning to us than ever before. If we don't, then we'll miss the meaning of Christmas and we'll not even be able to honor the Lord through it. He says, as the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You know, the interesting thing about that song, it was put out by Maranatha Music in 1984, and when it was put out, fundamentalists wouldn't sing it because it was a contemporary song. And it comes right from Psalm 42. And now, this book that we are singing, Bible Truth Hymns, is put together by one of the most staunch fundamentalist evangelists that you'll ever find in this country, and he has it in his book. What does that say? It says that not every new song that's written is a wrong song, is it? And this song, I remember a number of years ago, a group stood up and they sung a song, and the pastor or the preacher came up afterwards and really ridiculed that song. And he said, if they want to sing this song, they should sing Scripture. The song itself was an actual psalm. The problem was he didn't know his Bible. You know, we need to take a look at some of these words at times. There's another song I remember first time I sung it at my granddad's church. He said, don't ever sing that here again. We had a revival meeting, and Charlie Dyer and I were the song directors. And there was a fellow by the name of John Calhoun from Moody Bible Institute, who was the evangelist. And Charlie and I presented the song, It Only Takes a Spark to Get a Fire Going. Papa came afterwards and said, don't ever sing that in this church again. It's a contemporary song. Now, all the fundamentalists sing it. You know, what am I saying? I'm saying when you look at a song, look at its message. Look at its words. And here's one of the great illustrations. Is this biblically correct? Absolutely. And what a message it is. As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after you. As we go into the Christmas season, this should be our desire. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. Do we have that desire as we go into the Christmas season to worship the Lord? You alone are my strength, my shield. You alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You know, every one of us know that, in this building know that what Christmas is all about. Certainly Christmas is a time when Christians all around the world celebrate the incarnation of God in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Most Christians celebrate Christmas on December 25th, although we really do not know when the actual date of the birth of Christ was. You know, I have heard some people say that it really was December the 25th. Others have said it's some other time, and we really don't know when it is. But we do celebrate Christmas on December the 25th, and one of the things that has always been a concern to me as we've gone into Christmas is whether or not we really are keeping Christ in the center of Christmas. And I remember years ago making that statement when I was pastoring down in Lebanon, Pennsylvania, that it's very important that we keep Christ in the center of Christmas. And a lady came up afterwards and she said, "Don't ever say that again. Don't ever say we need to keep Christ in Christmas." And I said, "Why?" She said, "Because Christ never was in Christmas." Well, her name was Iona Doll, D-O-L-L, not doll like me, but D-O-L-L. She, the whole time during the Christmas season, she'd never sang a Christmas song. She was in the choir at the church, but during the whole time during the Christmas season, she'd never sing. She'd never sing. She wouldn't sing in the choir. She'd just sit down there about three rows back. I know of a whole church that for many, many years, they didn't do anything to celebrate Christmas. Well, you know, Jesus was born, wasn't he? He came into this world not to go to the manger, but to go to the cross. And I think that Christmas should be celebrated, but it must be celebrated properly and it must be celebrated biblically. And so tonight, for just a few moments, I want us to consider preparing for Christmas biblically. And the main thing to remember is that Christmas is all about Christ, and therefore he should be the one that's the very center of the celebration. That's why I made reference to the song that we sung, "As the Deer." The Lord Jesus Christ is the one that we should strive after, that we should exalt, that we should lift up, that we should focus during the Christmas season. That should be our prayer. That should be our desire. Because Christ is to be the center of everything that we do. You might want to turn to Colossians chapter 1. And, you know, the whole book of Colossians is a book that is designed to bring the preeminence of Christ into the picture. And Colossians chapter 1 and verse 18 says, in reference to Christ, that he is the head of the body, the church, who was the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have preeminence. In all things, not in some things, but in all things, all of our thoughts, all of our activities, all of our actions, all of our doings, he is to have the preeminent position. For sure, as we go into the Christmas season, it's his birthday, right, that we're celebrating. He is the one who should be in the center of it. Then you go over to chapter 3 in verses 17 and 23 and 24. It says, "And whatsoever ye do in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him." In other words, as we go into the Christmas season, let's do all in the name of the Lord. Then verse 24, verse 23, excuse me. "And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto men, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ." All that we do as a Christian is to be Christ-centered. Christ-centered. And as we approach Christmas, we must put forth the effort to keep Christ in the very central position. And I want to make a statement that some may think, well, that's a pretty strong statement, and I agree that it is. And you may not agree with it, but I want you to think about it. And that is that any celebration of Christmas without Jesus Christ is a mockery and blasphemous. Did you hear that? Let me repeat it. That any celebration of Christmas without Jesus Christ is a mockery and blasphemous. Why? Because Christmas, whether it was December the 25th or not, is not the issue, but Christmas is the time when we honor the birthday of Christ. And if we allow ourselves to get involved in any way, shape, or form with something that doesn't honor Christ, then we are mocking Christ. And we are bringing a blasphemy before Christ. We need to be careful about that. And so tonight, I want to share certain things to determine when preparing for Christmas biblically. I mentioned this morning that there are 14 points, and I guess you're a glutton for punishment in that you came out to hear it. But honestly, I'm not going to take too long with it, but I want to encourage you to take heed to these points, and that's why we have them on the screen. And let's look at the first one. As we approach Christmas, let's determine to focus on the real meaning of Christmas. You see, sometimes we focus on so many other things, and Jesus Christ is put out on the back porch somewhere. But what is the real meaning of Christmas? Well, let's look at these verses. Let's turn to Matthew chapter 1, verses 21 and 23. Now, I want to mention to you as you're turning there tonight that this message tonight is not biblical exposition. It's just designed to get you to think and to prepare your heart for a right Christmas celebration. Matthew chapter 1, verses 21 and 23. Notice, and of course you know Matthew 1 is where the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ was spoken of prophetically. I want to begin with verse 18. It says, "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise, when as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, and not being willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. Now notice, verse 21, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. Why? For he shall save his people from their sins." Jesus came into this world to save his people from their sins, and that's why we celebrate Christmas. You drop down to verse 22. "Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is" what? "God with us." And so you see, the real meaning of Christmas is God coming with us in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ to save us from our sins. That's what Christmas is all about. You see, the same thought brought forth very clearly over in the book of Galatians chapter 4 and verse 4. I know you know the verse, but let's turn and look at it. Galatians chapter 4, verses 4 and 5, where it says, "But when the fullness of the time was come," that is, in God's time, in God's second, in God's moment, "God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons." Christmas is a time when we celebrate God sending his Son, Jesus Christ, into the world to go to the cross for us. Let's, in all that we do, determine to focus on the real meaning of Christmas. Jesus is the real reason for the season. And let's focus on that. Let's never get away from that in any activity that we do. And everything that I'm going to point up on these next 13 points relate to focusing on the real meaning of Christmas. So let's go. Number two, determine to avoid distractions from the real meaning of Christmas. What I mean by that, there are certain parties, celebrations, and events that are void of Jesus Christ. Christians really should not participate in those. If in one way, shape, or form you happen to find yourself in some kind of a party or celebration or event where Jesus Christ is not there, then bring him there. You may be invited to a party and not realize that Jesus is not going to be invited. Well, when you see that he's not being invited, bring him in. Say to somebody, may I read the real Christmas story from the Word of God? Bring Jesus Christ into the picture. But don't participate in, do not go along with, do not be a part of the planning of any kind of a party, celebration, or event that is devoid of Jesus Christ. So that's that. Number three, and I'm just giving these to you for your own consideration. Number three, determine to keep your Christian testimony. How? By refusing to get involved with anything that dishonors Christ. You know, I've known of Christians to go to a Christmas party and get drunk. Now that's causing one to lose their testimony. And you say, well, what's wrong with, you know, taking a drink? Well, would Christ have done that in that gathering? So, you see, what we need to do is maintain our testimony for the Lord Jesus Christ. Whatever it would be in your celebration of Christmas that could potentially hinder your walk with the Lord before other people, don't get involved with it, because Christmas is to honor Christ, and doing something that dishonors Christ is going to cause you to not only lose your testimony, but to obviously bring shame to the name of the Lord. Let's go to number four. Determine to actively witness for Christ. You know, Christmas is the easiest time of the year to witness, simply because of the fact that people are singing Christmas songs. You know, you'll go into a ball and they'll be singing, "Joy to the world, the Lord has come," or "It came upon the midnight clear," or whatever the case may be. And of course, I realize that with this attack that's on Satan, that's on Christian, that's on this war that's on Christianity right now, I realize that at times Christmas carols are not being played, even in some of our malls and our stores and shopping centers. They've taken those away, but some places they are. And so, you know, when you're hearing the song "Joy to the World, the Lord has come," when you if you're checking out at a store, say, "Do you hear that song? That's talking about my Savior." And you know, we should be ready and willing to give our testimony or to give a witness for Jesus Christ in 2 minutes or less. And while the clerk is there, you know, working the whole thing out, you can say a lot about Jesus. You can say an awful lot about Jesus. And because this is a time when they're singing our songs. I've often said that when you pay your bills, put a track in it. When there's a parade, go to it. And pass out tracts. Think that might happen? Is such a thing going to happen soon? When? Thursday. We'll have an opportunity to go to the Altoona Christmas Parade and distribute tracts. But we do that to be a witness for Christ. And we're all involved and invited to be involved with that. And what a way to share Jesus with others. Number five, determined to be cheerful. How many of you got beat up on Friday, Black Friday? Did you? You got in a fight, Teresa. You were the recipient of a fight. You see, the reality of Christmas brings good tidings of great joy. Reflect that through a cheerful deportment. Good tidings of great cheer to all men, to all women, to everybody. And then sometimes, you know, we walk around and, oh, we're angry and we're snobbish and we're mean and we're nasty. What a way to show Jesus. What a way to show Jesus. This is the time of good cheer, the season of good cheer. People that know that you're a Christian and you don't have a cheerful attitude are going to say, what kind of a Christian are you, huh? All right, number six. I told you this is going to be a quick sermon. You didn't believe me, did you? Determined to give to God. Uh-oh. Now you're going to say, I knew I shouldn't have come to church tonight. Determine to give to God at least as much as you give to others. Now, you've never heard me say that before, have you? I say that every year. The Christmas is the celebration of the birth of Christ. It's fine to spend financially to give to others we know and love, but it may be robbery to give less to God than to others at Christmas. Whose birthday are we celebrating? Christ. You know, wouldn't it be funny if you had a birthday, if John DeLosier had a birthday party, and we were all invited to John's party, and we would come and we'd all give our gifts to Ron Lunghoffer? What would be wrong with that picture? You see, yeah, the wrong guy. Now, certainly Christmas is the time of giving gifts. But when we give a gift, we give it in the name of Christ, don't we? Or we should be. But if we are going to give $500 to our friends and loved ones, what's wrong with giving $500 to the work of the Lord? Well, everything's right about it. You say, well, I can't afford to give another $500 to the Lord. Well, then give less to the other people too. Now think about that just a little bit. There are always opportunities to give to the work of the Lord during the Christmas season. We have this opportunity to give to Desmond Tutu. Or not Desmond Tutu. hope not. Desmond Dua. Like that's cute, Phil, don't you? Desmond Dua. That could be a Christmas gift to a fella. You know, over there in Ghana, their whole year's salary is in the area of $1,500. To have to pay $1,000 plus $30 a day to get somebody, his son, namely, out of the hospital is on. You know, it can be a gift to him. You might have an opportunity to bless somebody with giving them a special gift through the work of the Lord. And I'm sure that we will have opportunities around the church here to do it. Well, think about that. It's Jesus' birthday. What's wrong with giving him at least as much as we give to somebody else in gifts? Let me put it this way. What's right about it? Everything. Everything. Number 7. Determine to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. All too often, Christians do not prepare to worship Christ effectively during the time when we are to celebrate his birth. Boy, this could be considered hypocrisy. I've seen church splits over the Christmas program. I've seen families divided over what they're going to do to celebrate Christmas on Christmas Day. You see, Christmas is how many days from now? 28. You ought to know, you work at Walmart. 28 days. Can we now begin to prepare our heart in these next 28 days to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth? You know, I've been involved with the church for for many years, but 42 as pastoring. And, you know, I have seen Christians in the church get so frustrated about what is going on in the church that they forget Jesus. And they don't worship him in spirit and in truth. Could that be hypocrisy? Indeed, it could be. Indeed, it could be. So, you know, consider it. Number 8, determine to avoid secularism. Secularism is the absence of God. Many businesses, institutions, retailers, etc., remove Christ from Christmas. Those who love the Lord will not get involved with those who take Christ out of Scripture or out of the picture. Did you see that? I believe that. Let me read that again. You'll say, boy, you're awful harsh, Gary. Well, who are we? Christians. Whose birthday are we celebrating? Taking Christ out of it is absolutely wrong. And so they're trying to secularize Christmas. They don't call it the Christmas season anymore. They call it the winter holiday. I heard they're not going to call it Easter anymore. They're going to call it the spring holiday. You know, we should not stand for that. But for sure, we should not get involved with it. Secularism is the absence of God. Many businesses, institutes, schools, you know, there are many schools today that do not sing the Handel's Messiah anymore or the Hallelujah Chorus because it's a Christian song. You know, if you've got children in the school and that school will not allow Jesus to be emphasized in the Christmas concert, you got to stand up and speak out a little bit. It's Jesus' birthday we're celebrating. It is. It is indeed. And so those who love the Lord will not get involved with those who take Christ out of the picture. So the question is, how can we get involved with a secular Christmas and still love and honor the Lord? What's the answer to that question? We can't. We can't. We say, well, I'm going to go there and get involved with it as a testimony. All right. Well, if you're going to go there and get involved with it as a testimony, bring Jesus into the picture. See? In some way, shape, or form, there will be opportunities for you to bring Jesus into the picture. If you're, you know, I have been invited to Christmas parties where Jesus was not. And because I'm a Christian or because I'm a pastor, I've been asked to pray. I pray the Christmas story. I pray the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I pray theology into that particular prayer. Why? To bring Jesus Christ into the picture. To bring Christ into the presence and the minds of people's thoughts. You know, secularism is anti-God. And anytime we get involved with that which is anti-God, it's wrong. All right, number nine. Determined to refuse to go into debt. I'm glad Tom's up front. Every one of these points, he's been saying, there's a good one. Keep it up, Tom. Keep it up, brother. And I want you to see something here. Being in debt is not necessarily charging an item. Now, I realize that some of you may disagree with me on that, and that's fine. But what really is debt? Being in debt is running up charges that cannot be paid off in a reasonable amount of time. That causes hardship and even keeps one from giving to the Lord's work. You know, if you put so much on that charge card that you can't pay your tithe on January the 1st, something is rotten in Denmark, isn't it? But if you put on that charge card that which you can pay off reasonably and still give unto the Lord, well, then fine. But the fact of the matter is, don't go into debt. I wonder how many New Year's resolutions are, I'm not going to use my charge card next year. Coming the next year, they use it just as much. You understand the point. Anytime that we are in debt to the point that we can't pay off that which we have put on that card, or whatever the case may be, in a reasonable amount of time, does cause hardship and keeps us from giving to the work of the Lord. Number 10. Determined to maintain a thankful spirit. Christians should always be thankful people. This afternoon, I listened to Chaz's sermon on television that he preached last week, and I'm that close to stepping down from here and putting him up there. Finally, we've got a man here who knows how to preach. And he said we should be thankful always, didn't he? You remember that sermon from last week? Christians should always be a thankful people, but particularly during the Christmas season, we should have a thankful spirit considering all that Christ has done for us. We talked a little bit ago about being ready to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. One of the ways to do that is to be thankful, to think about what all God has done for us and then give Him the thanks all the time. Is that a good one? Amen. That's a command. But if we're going around through the Christmas season and we don't have a thankful spirit, well, then I'm not sure God's honored. Number 11. Determined to portray a godly attitude all of the time. Christmas is the time to celebrate Christ. Any attitude bound in a Christian which does not reflect Christ, such as bitterness, anger, non-forgiveness, bearing a grudge, hate, selfishness, revenge, greed, etc., is totally dishonoring to God at any time. But at Christmas, it is a shameful way for a believer to go about life. determined to portray a godly attitude all of the time. Now, this should happen not just on the month of December, right? But on the time, during the time of the year, when we are speaking about Christ, when we are singing about Christ, when we are celebrating Christ, let's have a godly attitude. Number 12. Determined to be generous and give to the needy. At Christmas time, we celebrate the time when Christ came from heaven to earth to give the needy sinners of the world, to give to the needy sinners of the world. That's the ultimate of giving to the needy, isn't it not? Christ, a Christian should reflect that in finding ways to give to those who are in need. How many of you are going to be passing the ding-dong pot? That's right, Salvation Army. I just wanted to make sure you were awake. In fact, we're going to have the opportunity to be a ding-dong at the pot, aren't we? It's December the what? 10th over at Hobby Lobby. Encourage you, if you haven't signed up, do it. But you know what? We've done that before, and I've even sat back and watched people. You know, that goes, the Salvation Army, when you give the Salvation Army, it goes 100% to taking care, or at least most of it. We know that. Salvation Army is a reputable place. And it goes to taking care of the needy. Well, there's Marjorie. You're here. You sure are. God bless your little pea-picking heart. Am I glad to see you back? It's not a part of the sermon, but I'm still glad to see you back. You're here this morning. Good to see you then. Sorry I missed you, but good to see you. Your mom's not here tonight, though. She's sick. All right. Well, got that settled. We'll pray for her. But I've seen people, you know, there that person is ringing the bell. People just can't wait to get into that Hobby Lobby or that Kmart. And I'm sure that when they bought something, they had change given back to them. I'm 90% sure they had change given back to them, right? What's wrong with taking that change and putting it in the ding-dong pot when you come out? That's just one way of being able to do it. Give to every one of those that you pass. We're talking about giving to the work of the Lord or to others as much as, you know, we give to others. This is a good way to be able to do it. If you see a homeless person, give to them. If you know somebody that's not going to have a Christmas turkey, give to them. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, because that's what Christmas is all about. Number 13, determined to spend time in the Scriptures. No, do it this way, brother. Keep it up. I need somebody like you in the front row. Even though we know the Scriptures about the Incarnation very well, we will be blessed, strengthened, and further equipped to serve the Lord by reading them over and over again, both prophetically and historically. You say, what am I talking about? I'm talking about read the Messianic prophecies about the birth of Jesus Christ. Read the accounts in Matthew and Luke and John about the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Become familiar with it over and over again. Be fed on the richness of God's truth during the Christmas season. And yeah, you could probably say the Christmas story as much as anybody else, but read it from the pages of Scripture. Lord willing, next Sunday morning, I'm going to be beginning my Christmas series, and it's entitled A Look at the Messiah. There's four Sundays up to Christmas, and by the way, this year on Christmas, Christmas is on Sunday, December the 25th. We're not going to be having Sunday school or evening service, but we are having the morning service at 10:30, so put that in your calendar. Oh, here I go getting into my metal puddle again. I'm going to step down here, Tom. I'm going to sit beside you, okay? How you doing, Tom? Doing pretty good.
Doing okay, yeah.
Tom comes to church here, Faith Baptist, because he doesn't have any other church to go to on a Sunday night. And he also said he comes to church here because he likes to go to a church where we don't have, a rock concert and then a little devotional from the Word of God.
I like to come here because I truly believe in my heart that this place is true.
He says he likes to come here because he truly believes in his heart that this place is true. Now, I come down here to sit beside you, Tom, because I wonder how many people are going to say, I can't go to church on Christmas Sunday. For crying out loud, that's a family day. Church ought to close down on Sunday, right?
There are those people that say, I only go to church 3 times a year. One at Thanksgiving, one at Christmas, and one at Easter.
And some of them are called Christers because they go Christmas and Easter. But think about it. You know, what is the one day of the year we should go to church? Many people believe that. Even when Christmas falls on Sunday, is that the day to miss church? Mm-mm. Now think about it a minute. An uncle of mine said, I can't go to church on Christmas Sunday. That's the day for the family. Listen, Christmas is not the day for the family. Christmas is the day for Jesus. So here at church on Sunday, December 25th, we'll have an overflow crowd. And I'll drop dead. But the four message titles are the need of the Messiah, the prophecies of the Messiah, the birth of the Messiah. That obviously is an important one. And then on Christmas morning, the response to the Messiah. Spend time in the Scriptures. Keep Jesus Christ in the center. Go to church services. Honor the Lord. And then finally, number 14. Determined to show the love of Christ to all people. Amen. John 3:16 is an illustration of how God revealed His love to all. Let's say it together. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God loved everyone and gave everyone His Son, or gave His Son for everyone. What an act of love. Let's express the love of God to all we come in contact with always, but particularly during the Christmas season. So, if you're shopping and somebody hits you, give them a hug. However you can show your love to others, do it. Now, just for practical purposes, let's keep these 14 suggestions before us as we prepare for Christmas. Much effort goes into preparing for Christmas financially, party-wise, family-wise, etc. But let's prepare biblically and then watch how God will be portrayed, honored, and lifted up, which will bring us a blessing on the side that we don't even deserve. Keep Jesus first, always. But particularly during the Christmas time, keep Jesus, number one, in every aspect of our lives. Are these 14 things helpful? Not theologically deep, but I trust practical, to the point that as we go throughout the next 28 days, 27 days now, we've been here a whole day already. Okay. Let's keep these before us, and then let's watch God work. I think if we keep these before us, we'll be blessed with the real meaning of Christmas. As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. Can you really say that tonight? And can you really sing it to the Lord? We're going to sing it again, but first, let's stand for prayer. Father in heaven, as we come to you tonight and think of this message, these 14 points, just something a little practical for us to consider. And I pray, Lord, that even though we might have had fun with some of them, that we will be able to apply them to our lives. And Lord, help us to keep these things on the refrigerator or the mirror, bathroom, with our Bible, wherever they're up online, we can get them there. Help us to keep these thoughts before us so that as we go into the Christmas season, we truly will honor you and glorify you for who you are and what you've done for us in the person of Jesus Christ, in whose name I pray. And all of God's children said, let's sing it again, please, number 205.